Right. So as designers and developers, when we're creating bespoke websites, we want to finally control and curate the capabilities and styles that are available to the content creators who are going to be working with these websites we make. After all, what's the point of creating a beautiful, branded, accessible website if people can change the very intentional features that create that vibe and functionality that make the website so great? Hi, I'm Aruba, and I'm a web developer who specializes in building bespoke WordPress websites. And today we're talking about the recently released theme.json feature, which is finally part of WordPress core. Let's get started. Now, with the advent of the block editor and the introduction of blocks as the tools for building a website within WordPress and all of its pages, there are a lot more user-facing features that we have to control and curate and keep in mind when we're building these websites. There's that pesky drop cap feature. There are the typography settings, the spacing controls, the color palette, gradients, etc. For example, in a recent project, the designer intended for the color palette to only be available in certain blocks because it really didn't need to be available in lots of other places. And then there was also a few blocks where only a subset of that palette should be available, so that people don't accidentally use colors that are not intended for that area. But in the block editor, there is no straightforward way to make that happen. Once you add a custom color palette, it becomes available to any block that pulls in the color palette feature. You can't be like, oh, I want the cover block to only have these colors, but I want the group block to have these other colors. You can make it happen, yes, in a custom way, but the custom color palette feature that is built into the editor, that doesn't have that kind of fine control. Now, that is where theme.json file comes in. Theme.json is a configuration file that allows WordPress themes to set existing editor and block level settings. This is intended to not only take over and consolidate the various theme support calls we've been making to control parts of the editor, it also gives us easy access to granular settings that we never had straightforward access to before. Some that we did have access to, but it was annoying, and some that were in PHP, and some that were in JavaScript, and some that you had to really jump through a lot of hoops and create custom gimmicks to access. So this is really cool, and I see a lot of potential as the API develops further and more people adopt it as a way to set values and other settings as well. Now, before we get into the technical details of how to use the theme.json file, I think it's important to talk about the role it plays in your theme development process. Ideally, before you write any style at all, any CSS, you should actually be setting up your theme.json file. And whenever you're creating or configuring new features or formatting rules, your first question should be, does this, or part of this implementation, belong in theme.json? The idea is that you set up your variables, your custom CSS properties, right? CSS custom properties in theme.json. And then you use those custom properties, those variables, in your styles, in your CSS. So let's say that you have a background color on this website that you're building, and it's light gray. But a couple of months down the road, there is a small refresh, and for whatever reason, the color is actually tweaked so it's a little bit more beige. So the hex code is changing, right? Now, normally in your theme development process, you probably have a lot of pre-processing going on. So in order to make this change happen, what you're going to do is you're going to open up your editor, you're going to open up your SCSS file, you're going to change the hex code in the variable that you've been storing it in, and then you're going to recompile your styles, and then you're going to, you know, commit this to production, and then it's going to go live. That would be the regular process. And it's not a bad process. But if you had the theme.json file and you were using the custom property set in that file in your styles, what you would do is you'd open up just theme.json file, change that hex code, and commit to production. And that's it. No recompiling, no opening up your SCSS. one tiny little change in a JSON file, and you're good to go. This also, by the way, allows the global styles editor in the WordPress dashboard to make those same changes, but that's a little outside the scope of this video. So the purpose of theme.json, as I see it, is to create a flexible rule set file that cascades down into the rest of your styles. Cascades, CSS, haha. You're already doing this when you write your styles, you know, of any kind, but by putting it in your JSON file, you are taking these rules that are often scattered between PHP, CSS, and JavaScript now, and you're putting them all in one file. You're creating a single source of truth that communicates with the WordPress dashboard, with your PHP, with your CSS, and with your JavaScript. It's fantastic. So let's dig into how we actually use theme.json. In order to start using it, we actually have to create a file in our theme called theme.json. Yay! Here I've got a theme open that I'm working on for my personal site very slowly. And I've already created a file in the root of my theme called theme.json. Right now it's empty, which means that WordPress isn't going to recognize it yet. In order for it to recognize it, the very first thing we need to do is open this up with a pair of curly brackets and add our first key value pair, which is going to be the version. Right now, there is only one version. So we're going to add version colon one. And that's because theme.json was just released, really. But as it evolves, there are going to be ways to add more features, then some things will change, and the version is a way to ensure your file doesn't break with those new iterations, right? And then the rest of your rules are going to be in one of three current sections that we have available to us, and that's settings, styles, and template parts. Something to note is all the keys, right? So like version, settings, all of these keys, all these property names are always going to be written in camel case. This is something that we've adopted now that, you know, JavaScript work is becoming a bigger and bigger part of the WordPress environment. And so anything that's JavaScript related is all camel cased. So there are three main sections to the theme.json file that are currently available to us in WordPress core. They are settings, styles, and template parts. The settings section is a top level declaration area. You know, it's where you set up settings that are going to affect the entire body of your website. The style section allows you to set specific styles for particular blocks or elements like links or headings. And I know that's going to be of particular interest to a lot of us who build bespoke websites. And the template parts section lets you list the different template parts that are present in block template parts, which is a folder that you would add in your theme if you're creating your theme as a proper block theme. It helps you persist the settings of that template across all of its instances. That part is also a little bit outside of the scope of this particular video because we're not talking about block themes in general. We're just looking at the best way to incorporate theme.json into our existing bespoke theme development process. Okay, so let's add a color palette to our theme.json file. Now, if you have a theme.json file and it has nothing but a version in it, I'm gonna go ahead and save it and let's pop into this editor I have open. And let's say I type in some stuff into a paragraph. Now you can see that this is just the default color palette that we're seeing that WordPress comes with. But now if we go ahead and add our own custom palette, we will be able to change that. So let's go do that. Okay, so after version one, I'm gonna add a comma and then I'm gonna start a section called settings. So settings, and I'm gonna put a colon in front of it. And I know that we have to add another set of curly brackets because we're gonna have more key value pairs inside it. whenever we add custom palettes, we often want to disable the ability for users to set their own custom colors. We only want them to use the colors we've provided them in the palette. So in order to turn that off in theme.json, you have a property for color. So inside settings, we're going to add color and open that up with curly brackets again. And then we're going to have a property called custom, and we're going to set that to false. So if I go ahead and I save this, now I haven't refreshed yet. So for the color property, I have this custom color ability that lets me choose this. But now let's go ahead and refresh this. And now when I go and type something in and I go to the color area, you can see the custom color option, it's gone now. So it's really instant and it's really, really easy. Now let's add our own palette. So I have a palette for my theme. And what you do is underneath custom, I'm gonna add the palette key. And it's going to be, there's gonna be more than one color. So it's going to be an array. So I'm going to use these square brackets to indicate that there's going to be a list coming through. And I've got that already set up. And this is essentially the same thing. This part is the same as the color palette edition settings that we had before. So we've got slug, and we've got color, and we've got name. And that these are my colors in the palette. I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to save that, and then we're going to pop in here. Let's just hit update and refresh. And now when I go in here and go to the color, you can see that it has updated to show my palette with its names here. Okay, so what if we also know that our theme has the cover block, but instead of providing it with the whole palette, we actually only want them to have the ability to add this forest color and this sky color as the background. So right now, if I add a cover block, you can see the entire palette is available to me, but we don't really want that. What we want is only forest green and the sky blue color. So if we want to add a different color palette for the cover block underneath the color area, so if I just collapse that, you'll see, as the next section inside settings, we're going to add a blocks setting, a key value pair, open that up with a curly bracket, and then we're going to apply a custom color palette that is different to the cover block. So that is core/cover, and then open that up. And then once again, we're really just repeating this colors thing. So what I can do is I will open this up and grab this whole thing and I'll paste it here. Now, because we already have in the main custom color palette set that custom colors shouldn't be allowed, I can get rid of that here. And then in here, I'm going to get rid of these other colors that I don't want available for the cover block, like so. And then I'm going to hit save. Now when I go into the editor, I'm going to refresh it really quick and add the cover block again. And now you see the only colors that are available to me in the cover block is the forest green and the sky blue. And there you go. This is something that would have been so awesome if I had access to it in WordPress core like 3 months ago, not even. Yeah, 3 months ago, and now it is so easy. Like, you add in a few lines of code, and boom, you have a custom color palette that is specific to the block. You know, you're targeting the block itself, and it's not available everywhere else. I love it. As theme.json gets adopted, and we see more and more people using it, ideas and tips are gonna, you know, come up based on everyone's experiences on how to streamline and systematize your theme.json for a more efficient workflow. This is naturally going to happen. At this point in time, what I would say is every time you want to make a change, ask yourself whether it belongs in theme.json, and also review what you already have in theme.json and see if you can create that change using the properties and foundations you've already set up in that file. You know, that's, I think, an important part of making any kind of tweak or adding any changes or improvements to any theme or any kind of work, really. Review what you already have, because sometimes you might actually be able to do the stuff with what's already available instead of trying to make it brand new. There's also an interesting series that I think everyone should read. It came out recently by Rich Tabor, and it's a series on standardization for certain terms within block theme development. Particularly, he talks about color slugs, font sizings, and spacing. And the concept has a lot of merit. I personally already follow this philosophy in a way in my own themes, and I think that this is applicable even to us, those developers who are building basically only bespoke websites. Are our clients going to, on a whim, change from one theme to another theme on their own? No, they're not. That doesn't mean that it's not helpful, though. For me personally, it helps with context switching. So I'm going from project to project, and I don't have to try to remember what the color variable is, because the labels for my colors in my palette are all standard. It doesn't make sense to call the color green green, for example, right? Just because your palette has the color green in it does not mean the variable assigned to that hex code should be called green. It's far more useful and far more valuable to create a variable name that tells you about the purpose of that color. So in my case, the standard slugs I use are primary, secondary, highlighter, dark, and light. The primary color is usually the main brand color. The dark color is usually like the text color or whatever the darkest color is in the palette, which is going to be used whenever we need a background or something. Or a dark background, really. And then the light is usually the regular background and in light mode, for example. And then we have secondary, and then we have like a highlight color that is only used, you know, in call to actions or to make something stand out. And so these names, they tell you what the purpose of that color is. Rich proposes a different set of slugs, which is, I think, equally great. And what he proposes is at least having a foreground color and a background color. Right? So the foreground would be like your text color, and your background color is your background color. And then all your other colors are primary, secondary, tertiary, and so on and so forth. And I think that to a certain extent that makes sense. If I was going to nitpick, I would say that after a certain number of primary, secondary, tertiary, those terms, they start to lose their meaning, because now it doesn't tell you about the purpose of that color, it just tells you how important that color is or when it was added to the palette. But also, of course, if you have so many colors that this becomes a problem, there's something wrong with your palette probably. So it's a really great read. All three posts are live and I'll link them in the description below. And I think that we should all think about that and consider it and see how we can add standardization and systems like this, mini systems like this, into our process, because not only does it make it easier for us to switch context from project to project, it actually helps, you know, when you have a team or if you just say you decide that this was a great theme and I'm going to use a version of it and I'm going to release it into the .org theme directory. You know, there's a lot of different scenarios, and becoming a more efficient developer is always going to be helpful. I hope you found this video valuable and encouraging in your adventures in creating block themes or themes that support the block editor. This is a fairly brief introduction to theme.json, and I'm hoping to make a few more videos that dive deeper into what you can do with this file and show you some concrete examples based on work I've done before and how I would transfer that into theme.json now. Let me know in the comments or on Twitter if you have any questions and if there are other things you'd like to know more about. Have a fantastic day, and I'll see you in the next video.